Jordan and Gretzky, Serena and Ruth. Remembering great ones is easy to do.
But what about the no-names who spent their whole lives long-stepping footballs and catching sackflies? They're guys, remember that guy.
Remember that guy. Remember that guy. Remember that guy. Remember that guy. They're just gonna remember some guys now.
Intentional grounding, offense number 7. That's a 10-yard penalty. I'm talking to America here, excuse me. It's a 10-yard penalty and a loss of a down. It'll be Remember That Guy, the show where we mine our memories for nuggets of nostalgia about peripheral players, past and present. Hey there, folks. It's me, one of your hosts, James. I myself am ready to talk to America.
Diaz, back once again. I'm not quite ready, so I'll let you speak to America, James. But I'm more than happy to speak with you. And there is one more person that I'm very excited to speak with today. The person who so rudely interrupted that conversation with America. But he's here to explain himself now. Please introduce yourself.
Sorry, I was looking for the bathroom. And, you know, I just opened the wrong door. And I saw a person there. And that was the first thing I could ask. I do apologize for that interruption. It is me, the very special guest, Xavier.
I'm shocked you didn't just take the chance to put yourself in the shoes of New York Jets legend Geno Smith there, buddy.
Whenever I think of Geno now, I just think of, oh my God, and throw it.
Yeah, in the Aaron space Donald. Of Aaron Donald, which is the only reasonable response to seeing Aaron Donald coming at you.
When I was the scout team quarterback for varsity, there was one play where like the center was kind of like the team clown. And our star linebacker said to him, unbeknownst to me, after one play, he's like, hey, just duck down on the next snap. So I get in my stance. I'm doing my cadence. Go, black 27, black 27. Hut. Oh, shit. And our star 6'3", 240 linebacker is flying through the air to just land on top of me. So I feel you, Gino. I really do.
Xavier, I'm actually curious, what is the opinion of the Jets diaspora on Geno Smith nowadays? Are you guys mostly like happy for him to have gotten a shot?
I mean, I'm happy for him to have gotten a shot, but I also own him in Dynasty Football. So, you know, that helps me very much. So I am a biased, selfish party. But the thing, Geno's time with the Jets was really weird. Most people were on the side of Enampali when Geno got punched in the face. Geno was people thought Geno was arrogant for the Jets and hadn't done anything to deserve that. Like, him thinking that highly of himself. But it seems like he's matured a lot, and it took him a while to get where he's at. So I've got no, you know, hard feelings for Geno. He's not Christian Hackenberg.
So what you're saying is all we need for the Jets to turn this season around is for Sauce Gardner to beat the shit out of Zach Wilson. That's all we need.
I can think of some problems that would solve it.
It would then wait 10 years before Zach is good. So don't think
you
got to
get
now.
A jump on it now. Every day that you don't beat the shit out of Zach Wilson is one more day that he won't eventually be good.
There was someone I read this week who was listing like all of the potential free agent quarterbacks better than Zach Wilson. And yeah, as a bit, they list Joe Flacco last beat. Okay. Even I couldn't say that seriously. No. Look, I think Joe Flacco is a better option right now.
Have you seen the Jets' offensive line?
Yeah.
Flacco can't move.
He would
break both his legs on the first snap and look like the guy from the intro to RoboCop.
God, such a fucking good movie.
He would not exist anymore. Like, if Micah Parsons was there, Joe Flacco would have literally been sheared in half.
Well, Joe Flacco's not making memories for you, Xavier. Geno Smith's no longer making memories for you, at least not in the real world. May I ask what it is that does make a memory for you nowadays?
Yes. Real quick, I want to say quick update to the Spanish women's national team. Despite the team saying we're not going to respond to any call-ups, the Spanish Federation did call up a majority of the women from the World Cup winning squad, and there was a lot of confusion because technically Spanish law is such that if you turn down a request from your national team, they can remove your professional license for years and essentially ban you from being able to play that sport professionally. And so the women showed up, But they also demanded that they, you know, have conversations with the RFEF and try to come to some sort of agreement. After a lot of talks and a lot of confusion and weirdly getting sent across country last minute, they came to some sort of understanding where they're comfortable enough that there are going to be changes in the Federation, that 21 of the 23 women did decide to stay in camp and play for the team this weekend. Two others said that, you know, they respect the progress, but they still are not comfortable playing for the Spanish women at this time, which is a terrible thing to have to say weeks after winning their first World Cup. Luckily, part of the agreement was that those two women would not be punished in any way for not wanting to play. So there's still some stuff to go with that, but sounds like there's at least some sort of positives coming up. And then on the other end of the soccer spectrum, there's something that I'm sure both me and Diaz are interested in talking about. You know, Diaz might have had a more interesting experience watching Newcastle not play well, but Newcastle their way to a point. Arsenal destroyed PSV in their first Champions League game in over 6 years. And that was a really fun way to kind of get this season started after something that Arsenal fans have been really missing for a while. And the first goal had to be from Bukayo Saka, and it was just really fun experience. Hopefully that form carries over to the North London Derby this weekend, because a first Champions League win in 6 years and a North London Derby win would be a really good week for Arsenal fans.
And Newcastle got a point, baby. And that's what's important here. That's exactly what we came there to do. We went to the San Siro. It was just to see when they do the lineup before, because, like, as you just heard the brief little sound there, the Champions League theme song plays before each game. And when they're doing the pan down, there's three players in Newcastle's lineup that are, like, born and raised Newcastle fans. And Dan Byrne had so much pride on his face. Sean Longstaff had so much pride on his face. But it was Jacob Murphy who had just the other two, like, it was like respecting the solemnness and the seriousness of the moment. And Jacob Murphy just had the biggest dumb, stupid fucking grin on his face. Like, are you kidding me? Like, I was playing with this team in the championship like 5 years ago, and now we're playing in the Champions League. Incredible ascension. And what annoyed me, so I went to Fado. It's a nice Irish pub in Center City, and I watched theirs. And they didn't have the sound going, like, you know, they had like Taylor Swift playing or something, which is fine. Whatever. The moods were very different between the music and what I was watching and feeling. But what annoyed me was this Man City fan came in because their game was right after. And, you know, like, I'm not even playing Man City. And, you know, I'm watching with Mr. Medicinal, great friend of the podcast. And this Man City person is just generally unpleasant to both of us. Like, you know, fuck you guys, fuck your teams, your pieces of shit. And I'm like, hey, man, we're all just like American soccer fans here. I feel like American soccer fan is its own team.
He is explicitly creating conflict where no conflict exists.
The problem is, as anyone who has ever been on U.S. soccer Twitter knows, U.S. soccer Twitter is by far the most toxic sports fandom in the world. I don't know why, but it is absolutely horrible. Like, if you are a active poster on U.S. soccer Twitter, you're probably a terrible person.
Unless you were posting the BJ Callahan for president memes, in which case you are either me or I am a fan of you.
You are or no, Diaz.
Exactly. It's a very small circle. But no, what annoyed me was, you know, this guy comes in picking fights, and then they put the sound on for the Man City game for him, which I didn't even know was an option. I hate it. I hate it.
I will say one of my favorite things about soccer is soccer fans' hatred for advanced analytics and actual playing of soccer hatred of advanced analytics. Because so the Arsenal game was 4-0 over PSV. The expected goals there was 2.53 for Arsenal to 0.55 for PSV. The Newcastle AC Milan game was 0-0. AC Milan's expected goals was 2.34. Newcastle was 0.18. Like, people love to hate expected goals, and the reason is it feels like it's something that should show that things are not sustainable, but it just keeps happening anyway.
And let it be said, I think all 0.18 of that XG came on a 94th minute shot from Sean Longstaff, which very nearly went in and stole the game. I mean, I would have deserved the comments that the Man City guy gave to me if Sean Longstaff had hit that in. But look, I've said it once, I've said it a million times. I have my own XG formula, actually. Do you guys want to hear it? I'm ready to debut it.
Go ahead.
Yes.
If the ball goes in between the goalposts, but under the crossbar from a touch that was legally made, I expect that to be a goal. So far, for the history of soccer, it is 100% exact match. It is the most predictive analytic that there possibly is. And I'm so thrilled to share it with you.
We know some refs probably fucked some up back in the day.
Of course.
I mean, not even 20 years ago. Just like 3 years ago, there was an Aston Villa game where the ball went in, but because of blocking, like too many people crowded in the line, the goal line technology that was supposed to be there to say ball go over line could not see where ball was, even though cameras show ball very much over line. And then there have been very famous incidents of ball go side of net, ref doesn't see, calls it a goal, does not review. That's one of the reasons the USA did not make the World Cup in 2018. Panama had a ball that went side of net, not inside, and guy called it goal.
Listen, sometimes, as much as we love to honor guy, sometimes guy lie, sometimes camera lies, sometimes goal line technology lie, but ball don't. Ball has never lied. And yes, to your point, my XG metric is not 100% accurate, but I do argue it is the most predictive one that anybody's come up with yet.
I can't argue with that logic. You can argue with the score, which is essentially what your XG boils down to, and I have to agree with that.
Look, I'm a simple man with simple tastes, but again, if you can't tell, I'm not a fan of analytics. What I'm a fan of is guys getting together and playing sports and just seeing what happens. That's actually, there's a group of guys that have been doing that are making memories for me. Have either of you heard of Las Amazonas de Yashuna?
No.
Nope.
Well, let me tell you about Las Amazonas de Yashuna. They are a softball team based in Yashuna, Mexico. And what's notable about Las Amazonas is they all come from the same village. They are the official team of the Yucatecan Mayan group, I guess.
Nation.
Is how you'd want to say that. They are the nation.
If,
yes.
If we're going, that's the typical U.S. terminology, at least. So we can apply that to North America.
Yes. So they're the softball team. It is a community that had a high incidence of diabetes, different health issues. And basically they said, let's find a way to stay active. And they come together and they form this community team. What is especially notable about them is they play all of their games in the traditional huipil, which is a traditional Mayan dress. And they have a kinship with one of the guys done dirtiest by the Baseball Hall of Fame, Shoeless Joe Jackson, in that they play completely barefoot. It's not just the outfielders, the infielders. The catcher does wear a mask. I give her that. She has some like smallest modicum of interest in her like personal safety. But she's back there, no chest protector, no shin guards, no cleats. If a foul ball goes off your foot, walk it off, get back in the haunches. They just this week had their first game on United States soil. They played the University of Phoenix Valley Falcons, and they whooped some Falcon ass. They won 22-3 while playing at Chase Field, the home field of the Arizona Diamondbacks. I'm not going to try to say the names of some of these players because it's going to be just really bad. I had to practice
five times before.
I'm guessing
there's a lot
before.
Of X's.
There's, well, so I'm going to try. Lily Chan, Citlali Jib, Berenice I. They were noted for their excellence in hitting during that game. But yeah, a lot of very traditional Mayan names, which even me being a Spanish speaker, I don't stand the fucking chance with half of them. but I would probably stand a slightly better chance than the Falcons did, because again, 22-3 is just a straight ass kicking. And we got to give it up. We got to honor this team. The pictures are so cool. I'm going to send an article in our chat right now so you both can see. We'll post it on the Discord as well. I mean, it's just, they're just these traditional Mayan ladies who came here with bats in hand to hit the shit out of that ball, to catch the shit out of that ball. The ball don't lie. They don't lie. And they win. It's just one of the coolest things that I've seen in quite some time.
It begs the matchup of them versus the Oklahoma Sooners.
Yeah, like, exactly. We've seen enough from the Oklahoma Sooners, but it's kind of like the question, soccer thing. Like,
do we say, are they using aluminum bats or wooden bats?
They look aluminum.
Okay, yeah, that's what I wanted to assume. I was like, we're not talking that hard-pressed for equipment or anything. They're choosing to play without shoes.
Exactly, exactly. And, I mean, all the more credit to them. Maybe that's the reason I didn't make the bigs. I was wearing shoes too much. If I would have just heeded their methods, who knows what could have happened. But, no, it's awesome. All for these ladies. And, I mean, who knows? Like, they're the first team in the area. Does it beget a league? Does it beget even more interest in softball in Mexico? This could be our, oh, God, what do they call them? The Jamaican bobsled.
Cool Runnings.
Cool Runnings.
Cool Runnings.
This could members be our of the cool Hall Runnings. Of Guy, the Cool Runnings team.
Of course, of course. No, I blanked entirely there, so please forgive me, but I will not apologize for bringing up Las Amazonas, my new favorite softball team. Long may they reign.
Long may they reign. There is another entry onto the scene I would like to inform you guys. This tickled me a little bit. Quick question. Do either of you happen to know off the top of your head the name of the manager for the Minnesota Twins? Former Tampa Bay Rays legend.
Is it Rocco Baldelli? Rocco Baldelli.
It is Rocco Baldelli. Yes, Rocco Baldelli, manager for the Minnesota Twins. We've said it many a time. We love commitment to the bit. So congratulations to the Baldelli family on their newborn twins, Nino and Enzo, Rocco Baldelli's incredibly Italian twins that he just had this week.
Those kids are going to grow up to be wrestlers with those names.
Yeah, I mean, I got nothing more to say about that.
Shout out Rocco Baldelli for being the last sub that the Rays made in Game 5 of the 08 World Series, which the Phillies won.
Very nice.
I always remember that. He came in to pinch run at second, I think, after the runner got there. So theoretically, the tie-in run of Game 5, but only in theory.
Thank you for your contribution to Phillies culture, but I don't want to talk too much about grand entrances. I want to take a moment to talk about grand exits. This next segment, for any listeners of Baseball BarbieCast, will sound like plagiarism because I foolishly sent some of my research to them for a mailbag episode. No, I'm not foolishly. I was thrilled to be able to contribute this research to them, but it also made it onto their show. However, I think it's a good bit. So I do want to tell you for a bit about something that came up, the tour of Miguel Cabrera that's been going on this year. And I feel like hasn't really gotten a whole lot of play. Like, the Tigers aren't that much worse than the Cardinals were last year, and I guess he's not like quite as exciting as Albert Pujols, but I made a point to go to the Miguel Cabrera retirement tour earlier this year when he came to Baltimore. He was feted by fellow Venezuelan Anthony Santander, and the celebration has continued. In particular, in Anaheim, he got a surfboard from the Anaheim Angels, which is ridiculous in and of itself. Miguel Cabrera never going to surf, just not going to happen. But I was like, someone's gotten a surfboard before, right? And it turns out many someones have gotten surfboards before. So I'd like to ask you, before we go further, do you guys have a guess off the top of your head which team has given out the most retirement surfboards, I'm calling them?
San Diego.
I'm going to go with the Giants.
Okay, we're going to lock those two in. So retirement tours, the modern one kind of started with the Cal Ripken, Tony Gwynn season. I can't find any records of either of them getting surfboards. Cal just got different kinds of crabs in every city. Love that. But in 2012, this is the first retirement surfboard in baseball I could find. Chipper Jones gets one from the San Diego Padres. In 2013, Mariano Rivera gets one from the Oakland Athletics. And like, Xavier, I know you said San Francisco. I'll go ahead and spoil it. This is the only one from the Bay Area. There's not like
San Francisco.
In the Bay Area.
I didn't say
I'm
that.
Sorry.
I said San Diego.
Diaz did. Diaz, you're quite wrong. this is the only one from the Bay Area.
I shouldn't have applied logic to this. It's probably like fucking Kansas City for some reason.
Rivera gets this one from Oakland during his one. The next year, this is our third straight year. And this one, technicality, because Derek Jeter from the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim gets a paddleboard, which looks like a surfboard, except next to Derek Jeter, it looks like a giant one because it's twice his height. I'm going to give the Angels, in my opinion, a half point for this. Then we take a year off. And in 2016, the San Diego Padres hand out two surfboards this year. Two surfboards. 2016. And he guesses to who they're for.
2016.
Yeah. There's one you should get. Takes the team to the playoffs. Great final season. Like, goes out on a high note, knowing it's going to be the last one.
Oh, Big Poppy?
Big Poppy, yeah. David Ortiz gets one. The other one goes to Vin Scully. Give a fucking surfboard to Vin Scully. And then last year, San Diego strikes again with two more, one each for Albert Pujols and Yadier Molina, with the one this year that Miguel Cabrera receives the final score. Oakland has handed out one. Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim have handed out one and a half. San Diego Padres handed out five surfboards. I mentioned earlier that the chipper one was the first one in baseball. And this is almost exclusively, as far as I can find, a baseball phenomenon. You know, Haslam got his chair, but there isn't quite the same gift-giving phenomenon. However, I did find one earlier example of a retirement surfboard during a particular basketball player's retirement tour. In 1989, here's some of the gifts this basketball player got. A silver Rolls-Royce, a Harley Davidson motorcycle, a 24-foot sailboat. Six different teams gave this player a large collection of rare jazz records. And then we also had, from the Los Angeles Clippers, a surfboard. The first example of a retirement surfboard I can find, 1989. Gentlemen?
I know. I'll let you guess if you want to try, Xavier.
Well, I was thinking, weren't the Clippers in San Diego at that point? Were they the Los Angeles Clippers already, or were they still the San Diego Clippers? No, they left San Diego in 84.
Okay, there we go.
89, say Magic.
You're so very close.
Is it Larry the Bird?
No, Magic was not diagnosed HIV positive 89. Until 92. 89, you're thinking of the wrong Lakers legend, Xavier. It's not Big Game James. It's not Magic. It is the man who LeBron unseated for most points in NBA history.
Oh, Kareem. Okay.
Yeah. The thing that I didn't give you was that the 24-foot sailboat was nicknamed Captain Skyhook. That one would have given it away.
Yeah, that would have.
It's very good, though. But retirement surfboards are making memories for me, as are emails about retirement surfboards making some of my favorite shows. All of that making beautiful memories for me. But of course, we are not just here about memories. We are here to remember guys from further back, and we're going to go ahead and take that help now from our featured guest this week. Let's go ahead and throw to that segment. Ladies and gentlemen, and everybody else, our guest today, we'll say multi-talented player, and you could take that to mean the fact that he's been professional fullback, but also at many other levels, operated in all three phases of the game. And that would be accurate, but there are certainly several other games beyond just football that this guy plays. Please welcome to the show our guest, Johnny Stanton.
Hello. Thanks for having me. Excited to be here.
We're excited to have you. Again, like as I said before we started recording, you are by far the most reputable athlete to join us. We had a D3 basketball player. I'm a pretty good shooter in pickup games, but nobody that's ever actually been paid to play sports. This is a thrill for us as well.
Sorry, I thought this was part of my take. My bad. I went on the wrong show. Sorry. I'm excited to be on the show, guys. And I love your guys' idea for the show. I was just telling you, like, this is a super fun format. I get to reminisce about some cool guys that we may have recently forgotten about. And it's great to be able to just like bring back some recognition because our culture moves so quickly. Like the news cycle is like a week long now and people forget about what happened 2 weeks ago. So even just reminding everybody about like somebody who was like really big, like 5 years ago, maybe who has completely dropped out of their maybe 15 minutes of fame or whatever is I think really great.
Absolutely. We appreciate the praise there. Now, to give a little more background on where you're coming from nowadays, we alluded there, you play a lot of things in addition to football, and many of those are a passion of Xavier and mine's. Tabletop role-playing games. I will admit that I first became aware of you thanks to the Sports Illustrated article by Alex Pruitt. It came out in 2021, Role Players, talking about you and the Cleveland Browns locker room at the time, the game you guys had going on. And I have since then followed you for that as much as the football. So it is exciting to also get to kind of, you know, talk with someone that enjoys dice as much as two out of three of us do.
I appreciate it. It was a really cool moment to be able to get into Sports Illustrated for the first time for playing Dungeons and Dragons. And it was fun to be able to, you know, I grew up reading Sports Illustrated and, you know, getting the Sports Illustrated for kids when I was in elementary school, and to have the actual story come out in print in Sports Illustrated for kids was a cool moment. Like the awesome cover art for the story, which was Miles like fighting a dragon. And I'm like, hey, can I get in contact with the artist who did that? And when I got in contact with them, I'm like, hey, can you redo this? Now, can you like not redo it, but just paint out Miles's number and skin tone and just like make him white and give him number 40. And then I'm going to put it on a framed like fame thing in my office. Cause that's super cool. Just have like the Sports Illustrated and the dragon, me fighting him. Like that's neat for me. I'm just a big nerd.
Well, so that's a question I had. Based on the article, as I understand, you came into like D&D and that world like around college or so, but you've been playing football at that point. Did you have other like either fantasy or that kind of creative slash dramatic outlet along with sports the whole time? Or is that really like the first time you kind of had?
No, that was definitely the first time I had something like that because I didn't have a creative outlet. You know, I got to take film class in high school for 4 years. That was my creative outlet. But then again, you're only making like three or four of these videos a year. You're spending the rest of the time doing pre-production or post-production on it. And this was finally an opportunity for me to be able to tell like some kind of serialized storytelling or long form and more like learn about it, because you're really learning about it by consuming it. And I didn't even realize that there was a way to consume it until like months into playing it. When I was big into comic books. That's the kind of the first like really nerdy thing that I did. And that was right at the end of high school, beginning of college. We'd just be a regular at my local comic book shop. And then I start kind of dabbling into the D&D side of things on YouTube, and then realizing like, oh, this is actually like a major format after I started actually joining a group at my local comic shop. So that's when I found about it, the Adventure Zone and Critical Role, and much later on NADPOD, like all these different crazy shows. I mentioned 20. That I've actually, like, it's been amazing to me to be able to like build relationships with the people who are on the shows now, because I'm just as big of a fan as anybody else. So it really came at a time when I was injured, and you know, I was trying to get back from my knee injury, and it wasn't, you know, football wasn't going the way that I wanted to. I had just transferred from Nebraska and then to junior college, and now I'm at UNLV, and I didn't get to have the college football experience that I thought I was going to have. I thought I was going to come out of it, you know, winning a Heisman trophy and getting first round overall pick, you know, and it's just like everybody else does. And that's not the way it happens for 99% of the people. And for me, finding more of my identity, my self-identity through just play and like in role play and all these great avenues for finding out more about yourself and the people around you and how to empathize with them and how to interact with them in a way that you might have not expected that you could, was really special for me to be able to find that creative outlet.
Well, I love to hear you talking about kind of the ability to take a lot of those social and interpersonal relationship skills from it. Did you manage to take like any other kind of gameplay foundations from that for your game?
Well, I think I take more football into D&D and TTRPGs than I take TTRPGs into football. I mean, it's kind of hard. One's been around a lot longer than the other. and it's hard to change football. I think if anything, the best way I was able to change my game from TTRPGs was just branding myself and figuring out a way to actually be able to stand out. And that wasn't the reason why I became like very outspoken with me being a gamer, but it helped, you know. But I definitely brought a lot of football into TTRPGs, specifically with obviously bringing my teammates into my games, talking to the media about it and social media, having a charity game 2 years ago, or yeah, a year and a half ago, which raised $18,000, which was really cool. Got brought my teammates into there and a couple of D&D celebrities. And then just very recently, and I don't know when this is going to come out, but on September 22nd, I'm actually finally releasing my Path of the Gridiron Barbarian subclass on my website, which will line up nicely with this really cool YouTube channel that does, they build a character and then they build this short voice acted story around it with like some light animation, some cool character art. And I got to voice the character based on the Path of the Gridiron subclass. So that's going to come out along with a t-shirt that I built around the subclass that Unite the Realm, which is a really cool t-shirt company based out of the UK. So there's a lot of things kind of lining up here. So if you're a D&D player and like football, I think you're going to like the Path of the Gridiron subclass.
Yeah, this will have all come out I believe Friday before this episode comes out. This is Monday. Okay. So yeah. Folks, you can go find that right now.
StantonIV.com, D&D backstory on YouTube, and UKNITETHEREALM.co.UK. I think I got that URL right. You can find the website. You can find pre-order t-shirt there.
Yeah. As long as you keep the episode running while you do. Otherwise, wait like 40 minutes and then you can go look it up. So I did have one final question about something that you hit on there a second ago, how you've been able to like bring people from sports into this gaming world. And I'm just kind of curious, have you been able to really make it go the other way? We're talking about here, we're trying to sit down in this format and just like talk and reminisce about like narratives that we enjoy, which doesn't feel that far off in some ways. And I wonder if you use that as a bridge to like get some nerdier people that otherwise might not have considered the appeal of sports to come over to this dark side.
Oh yeah. I mean, just as unapproachable as D&D and TTRPGs seems to people outside of that community, sports is very much that as well. I mean, if you try to sit down without any kind of, you know, prior context to what football is and just learn about what the rules are in a book, you're not going to understand it until you actually experience it or somebody's able to teach you through it. So that's something that I've been very aware of and wanting to help these communities kind of combine. So that's why I created this recent series called Athletics Check. If you're familiar with D&D, you know there's a skill check called an athletics check, and I think it just matched up nicely with my brand. And it's basically a way for me to be able to teach nerds about football and me to be able to teach jocks and fans and just athletes about D&D. So I'm kind of alternating episodes on my Instagram and TikTok channel talking about, oh, this is what, you know, Jamal Williams might be if he was a D&D character, or these are the kinds of stories that we tell in D&D and kind of relate it to how a campaign is like a career and every season is like an arc of a story, and just breaking it down like that. It's exciting for me to be able to do it. I will say that the analogies are often tenuous. It's not perfect analogs, but I'm doing my best to be able to make sure they line up as best as possible. And hopefully there's some other growth there with Athletics Check to see just how many people we can combine in these two different, you know, worlds of huge fandom.
I mean, I have a lot of questions, but I don't want to take up too much time.
You guys are the ones editing this.
Have you finished Baldur's Gate 3 yet?
I just finished Act 2.
Okay, it's we're so long. Kind of in I've the same like, spot then.
I've spent like 80 to 100 hours probably, and wow, just about half another 40 hours, 30 hours maybe, just playing with my wife because she's gotten obsessed with it. And, you know, I can only play Baldur's Gate on my own because I don't want to spoil it for her because I'm a whole act ahead of her. So anytime we're together and she wants to play it, you know, she'll play her tiefling rogue and go through all the storylines and ask me, what do I do here? I'm like, I can't tell you. This is a role-playing game. You get to make these decisions. Like, but I don't want to screw it up. I'm like, I understand that. You're not going to screw anything up. You just hit save right before this. You're going to be okay.
What character did you end up making for that?
I played a Dragonborn Ranger.
Ooh, that's a good combination.
Yeah, I've never played a ranger before, actually, in a campaign. And this is a little bit of a character concept that I've been playing around with. And obviously, you don't get to instill your own lore and backstory into your character, but it's fun to at least get used to the mechanical stuff, so you understand what you can do once you do start playing it.
I love that. I saw your tweet about Karlach, and I was like, oh, phenomenal! This is fantastic. And I also
Parallax, my favorite for sure.
She's great, but I haven't really played with her that much just because of the way I had set my team up. But sure. as a character, I think she's awesome. But
oh, I definitely want you know more Astarion to be around me, and I haven't met Minsk yet. I know he's a ranger, so obviously I won't be able to use him too much in my party. But yeah, Karlak fits in just nicely with my party of Shadowheart and Gale, which I feel like is kind of the basis, like the basic party. Your Tav.
Yeah, but Shadowheart and, you know. Shadowheart's a great character. I think they set it up for everyone to have Shadowheart in their party, just as the cleric. But oh, yeah. I was also reading your week two takeaways on the blog, and I saw you called the Detroit offensive coordinator Jensen Ackles.
What did I spell it wrong? Did I?
No. His name is Ben Johnson, but he looks Ackles,
oh my god! I'm
supernatural.
So embarrassing. The reason why I had that in my head was because I had to figure out. Like I was asking my buddy who is helping me get into sports writing. Oh, it's so embarrassing. It's been out a week now.
I thought it was just a fun reference to Supernatural. Oh, so I think I think you're fine.
Pretend I never said. How many people listen to this? Because people are gonna be so embarrassed.
Not enough. This will be a problem. I promise that much.
I'm
gonna be changed. Yeah. No. It's fine. I'm gonna change it before anybody else sees it. What happened was I asked my buddy he's the one who helped me decide to start doing some sports writing, and I was trying to find anywhere. Is it? Oh god, I'm blanking on names now because I'm all screwed up. The Detroit head coach,
Dan Campbell.
Dan Campbell, thank you. I was trying to remember if Dan Campbell or Ben Johnson was the play caller, because obviously oftentimes head coaches have taken that role. And he said, no, Ben Johnson has the play calling role. And then he said the Ackles name, whose name I'm Jensen Ackles. And that's where I must have been tired trying to finish this column and just grabbed the name from, from the text thread. And yeah. By the time this is out,
they
you
look
won't be
the
able
same.
To see
that. They look very similar. I will say that. I just
it was a joke he made and just completely screwed me up. Yeah,
yeah, and I was only bringing it up because you know I'm running a Monster of the Week campaign, so nice. I saw that and I was like, oh, that's a super
funny joke
reference. That's a funny joke.
And for anyone that ever saw it, they'll think that.
If they even paid attention, I probably only had like 5 people read this thing. But thank you for bringing that to my attention.
Well, speaking of things being brought to the attention of others, this tribunal stands before you with the understanding that you have a guy to bring before us.
I do. I do have a guy to bring for you. It was a hard decision because it's such a wide open, like, ask. It's like, hey, bring somebody to the table that you think people want to hear about. And, you know, on the surface, that's like a really easy thing. Like I asked my buddies, I'm like, hey, who do I bring? Like, you know, what do I talk about here? And this person did not come up. It was somebody that I hadn't thought about him in a while. And I definitely had a lot of fun reminiscing. This is somebody that I have had a lot of previous experience with, who hasn't been in the news lately for a few years. I mentioned to you guys before the call, this is college football related. I also asked if I'd be allowed to say expletives on the show, because I think you cannot separate this man and curse words. The guy that I'm coming to the tribunal with today is former college football head coach Bo Pellini. I don't know how familiar you guys are with Bo. Bo was my first college head coach when I was at the University of Nebraska. Do I let you guys like respond to this and like see what your guys' response? Like, I want to hear what you guys think about Bo.
My first thought is I feel like when I think of the Bo Pellini era, I think of the fact that there was somehow a Martinez that was at quarterback like the entire time, like for a decade. It felt like it was just always Martinez, the starting quarterback.
It's close. I want to let the rest of you guys respond. When I was a freshman there, Taylor Martinez, who was, I think, the first Martinez to go there, was in his senior year. And my hope was that I was going to, you know, take over for him my redshirt freshman year. That's not obviously what happened. But Taylor was there. His little brother, Drake Martinez, was in my recruiting class. He played safety. He ended up transferring to Michigan State after his freshman year. And then there was another Martinez who played at quarterback a few years after Taylor was done, a few years after I had graduated, or maybe like my senior year or something. So yes, it seemed like Martinez was under center for like the whole time, and you're not totally wrong.
It's like,
and this was the second Martinez quarterback came after Bo was gone, actually.
Right. It's like Martinez quarterback for Nebraska. Mm-hmm. There's going to be a Plumlee at center for Duke. Like those two families, I felt like had strangleholds.
Yeah. No, it's the Vanderbilts and the Rockefellers of the college football world.
Exactly.
Well, and the fact that one follows after, just before we even get into it, that's clearly a strong legacy that Bo's been able to build and carries on following him. I'll just say, as the most college football agnostic of the three of us, I'm fully aware of who Bo Pellini is, and he's exclusively for the reason that you checked with us ahead of time. So I'm excited to learn more, but like, I do know that he is an excellent character.
Yes, character is the key word there for sure.
When you first said his name, I was trying to put the timeline together because I was like, wait a second. I thought Bo was at Youngstown by then. So I was like trying to like rack my brain for the timeline. But I'm very excited to hear more about Bo Pellini, especially from someone who actually knew him. So
yeah. And I hesitate to say that I played for him because I did not play much in Nebraska. But yeah, Bo was who recruited me to Lincoln. He was actually at Youngstown State when I was in Cleveland. I never made it out to Youngstown. I haven't spoken to Bo since I graduated or since I actually transferred away. I will preface this by saying I really enjoyed playing for Bo. I really enjoyed being on his team. He is 100% a player's coach. Anybody who played for him would say that. Anybody who he worked for or coached against him would also say that, because he was... fuck everyone else. We're going to keep it in house. I'm going to protect my players. He's always trying to take the blame onto himself. So yeah, I will say up top, no matter what stories I tell, and I will not tell every single thing. he is a character, to some a controversial coach, but just a legendary guy who I have the utmost respect for. So should I just like start from the beginning for him? Like read his Wikipedia page.
We start with some facts up front.
Sure.
I always usually start like, this is the birthday. This is where he's born. Okay. X amount of brothers, sisters, but
yeah. All right. Well, I didn't think about his birthday, but he was born December 13th, 1967. He's 55 years old. Bo is one of those guys who college football is like in his bones. At the very least, football is. His older brother is Carl Pellini, who also coached at Nebraska and at Youngstown State with them and at other locations. I think the thing about Bo is that he is a competitor to his very core. He is someone who cannot turn off his competitive nature, which can get him in trouble. And I guarantee he'd be the first person to tell you that. So I met Bo when he was in his fourth year or so at University of Nebraska as their head coach. He got brought in, hired by Tom Osborne, legendary college football coach. Nebraska has an incredible tradition of college football, especially in their coaching. In the 90s, they won multiple national championships, and I don't think Lincoln, Nebraska has evolved past the 90s because of that very moment. I think, you know, it's kind of like in your own lifetime, you know, you kind of end up keeping the same identity and personality as you did when you peaked, whether that's some people who peaked in high school or some people who, you know, was in their late 20s or whatever. You kind of carry that self-identity over, you know, past that point. And I really think that that's Lincoln. Lincoln is an incredible place, but in a lot of ways, it is still in 97 or whenever the last time they won a national championship was.
They're still just talking about Darren Erstad. They just cannot.
Yeah, no, it's more like Tommy Frazier and Couch and all these different guys who, you know, they're one of their main recruiting tools at Nebraska is you go into the stadium, and this Memorial Stadium is legendary. It's huge, 90,000 plus. When it's full, which it has been for the last like nearly 400 games, they have the longest sellout streak in college football history. You walk into this entrance and there's this like glass waterfall in the front. It's a very nice intro. You see all like the awards on the side. And then you turn left towards the actual facility in the weight room and the locker room. And there's this door on the left that slides open. It's completely different from the rest of the building. It looks super futuristic and like kind of weird in that way. And you walk in and you see like this light show starts. Like this is one of the first things you do when you show up to the stadium. It's going around and then it tells like this 5 to 10 minute video about the Heisman Trophy winners for Nebraska. And they have the trophies themselves in these like rotating shelves that like are flush with the wall. So they'll play this video for like Tommy Frazier. And at the very end of the video, it'll like zoom in. The lights will all zoom in on the height, like on this like cutout from the wall, and it'll rotate kind of like, you know, Haunted Mansion style.
I was gonna say, it feels very Disney Park AV setup.
It's very, it very is, yeah. And then you see the Heisman Trophy and all the lights on there, and it swivels back around. You get the next story. So Nebraska is like, college football is legendary there. The Cornhuskers are, you know, celebrities within Lincoln. So enter Bo Pellini. He is an old school coach. He is fiery, to put it lightly. He is a defensive minded head coach. So right when you kind of get that vibe, you know that he's going to be getting on you. Like offensive coaches are usually a little bit more cerebral, not to say that he's not, but a little bit more soft spoken and thoughtful, because, you know, you're an offensive play caller. You need to be thinking about like two steps ahead, where Bo is like just a fiery guy. He's there to motivate you. He is there to get angry at you and then to let you, that emotion flow through you into violence on the football field. So yeah, he recruited me when I was coming out of high school. I graduated in 2013 from Santa Margarita Catholic here in Southern California. And it was after my junior year, winning the state championship here in California, and I started getting a little bit of recruitment. And that was foreign to me. I didn't know what to expect. And then that summer, I decided to start doing a bunch of traveling to different schools, doing camps, and among them being Nebraska. And it was one of the schools that I got recruited by. And I decided that summer to commit to the team. I didn't have that much relationship with Bo at that point. It was mostly with the offensive coordinator and the quarterback coach. And I remember one of my first memories of Bo is the home visit. You know, the home visit is kind of a legendary milestone when it comes to football recruiting. And you only get one of them. At least I think the head coach can only visit once. The position coach can maybe visit multiple times. But there is, you know, at least when I was in college, there was a limited amount of contact that you could have, or when I was in high school. And I remember very clearly, I had torn my ACL my senior year of high school, and I was out after 5 games. It was a bummer, but Nebraska was like holding to my scholarship. And Bo came, the offensive coordinator came, we're all sitting around the dining room table, we're kind of just chatting. It's not an opportunity really to recruit, because at that point I was already committed. But there were kind of conversation between the coaches and my parents, and just kind of getting to know each other. And I was already communicating with other guys in my recruitment class, and guys who are linebacker, receiver, running back. We're all in like group texts or Snapchat threads or whatever. And I thought, oh, let me sneak a picture of Bo when he's talking to my parents. So I have my phone kind of flat on the table, and I like kind of slowly raise it to turn on the camera and to press the button like really sneakily. Sure enough, the flash is on. One of the most, I immediately slam my phone down on the table. And I'm like, I think all of us at the table are going to pretend that that didn't just happen. Because nobody made any kind of mention of it. And my face super red. We're just going to continue down this line of conversation that I cannot remember at all. But that was like one of my first interactions with Bo. Oh man, I went very quickly away from his actual facts, but I'll give a really quick just rundown of his career. The highlights are: started in his NFL coaching career as a DB coach for the 49ers, moved on to linebacker coach for the Patriots and the Green Bay Packers. And then that's when he started at Nebraska as a defensive coordinator at 2003, became the interim head coach, ended up taking a job over at Oklahoma. Then was very notably at LSU as the defensive coordinator for a few years of very high quality teams. And then for a 6-year, 7-year stretch, he was at Nebraska as their head coach, 2008 to 2014. during that time, I'm going to try to find his actual record. I apologize. I should have had this ready. The main highlight is that he had a very good record while at Nebraska. He was extremely notable for having several 9-win seasons in a row, like 5 or 6 9-win seasons in a row. College football, you play 12 games. You would think that is a great season. But the Nebraska faithful are very demanding. And when you don't show progress and production and improvement on that 9 wins, people start to get antsy.
Xavier has this smile on his face, and I feel like it's the
feeling. I need to let you guys talk more. I feel like I've just
been talking. No. Just I can see him realizing that, like, this is very similar to a franchise he's familiar with that has like a couple World Series or championships back in the 90s, and now
it's incredibly exacting
standard and never allows for just enjoying a 9-win season.
No, it's not that. It's not that. It's just that I think about Pellini was so solid, but solid wasn't good enough for Nebraska at that point. And since they got rid of him, it's been
it's a different world.
Like they would pray for a 9-win season at this point with the stuff that happened under Mike Riley and then Scott Frost. And you two know that I love Matt Rhule, and I've met him multiple times. I think he's a fantastic person, and I hope he does well there. But hasn't started off too great so far. So, I mean, the days of Bo Pellini, they're looking on it a little
a little
more rosily now than it was.
And it was so interesting because there was such a dichotomy between the way that the fans and the media saw him and the way that people inside the building saw him. And that oftentimes happened. It's you know, Bo's not the first, nor will he be the last player's coach that people demanded more of. But there were just so many. And the main reason why I wanted to bring him up was because there are just so many stories that surround him in and around the time that I was in Lincoln. And I was only there for 2.5 years, but boy, was it a roller coaster. He ends up getting fired after my redshirt freshman season, which was another 9-win season, I believe. Gonna check really quick. They began the season ranked 22 and they finished 9-3, ranked 25th, and he got fired. There was a new athletic director and there was a lot of things that were going on, but I will say on his Wikipedia page, if you look, there is a category that just says controversies. And there are 3 subcategories underneath that. And I will run through them. Not all of them happened while I was there. One of them did. As I said, he was incredibly criticized by the media and the fans while he was there, because he wasn't particularly friendly to them. The Nebraska fans are pretty well known for their hospitality, Midwestern hospitality, you know? And to be able to prepare for this, I was listening to Bussin' with the Boys podcast, because it's not like one of my normal listens, but Will Compton, who I didn't cross over with at Nebraska, had Pellini on a couple years ago. And I just wanted to listen to their conversation and to see like what they talked about, see if it kind of brought back anything. And just hearing him talk about how I think he would have gotten fired earlier from Nebraska if it wasn't for the 9-win seasons, because he was successful despite not necessarily having the most amount of support in Lincoln. So yeah, the first thing, and this is before I get there, that underneath controversies, the first thing is the first audio tape leak. And I remember a lot about this. This was following a home loss to UCLA in 2013. Oh, wait, I was here. Oh my gosh, I remember a lot of things coming back to me. There's something else. There's something that wasn't mentioned here. This is what it was. Okay. So following a home game loss to UCLA on September 14th, 2013, and shortly after responding to criticism from former Nebraska football player Tommy Frazier about the loss, a 2-year-old audio tape, that's what it was. It was the fact that the audio tape was old, but it didn't come out until it was my freshman year. One of the first games of the season when I show up at Nebraska was anonymously leaked to Deadspin. And it was timed perfectly. It was a loss to UCLA. It was a big game. This was, I think, the second game of my freshman year, and the stadium was packed. This was actually right after UCLA lost one of their players to a car crash. Nick Pasquale, I played against him in high school. A really great guy, really great player. So it was a big win for UCLA to be able to come into our house and beat us. And there was a ton of criticism following it. So the recording was made following Nebraska's come-from-behind win against Ohio State in 2011, when it was reported that almost all of the students and more than half of the stadium left while Nebraska was down at half 27-6. But the Huskers won 34-27, marking it one of the biggest comebacks in school history. It was the biggest comeback in school history. And Pellini couldn't have been more mad about the fact that all the fans left. I don't think a lot of college football head coaches would make it that big of a deal, but this is what Pellini had to say. And again, I apologize. These are Pellini's words, not mine. Pellini said, "Our crowd, put a bunch of fucking fair weather fucking. They can all kiss my ass out the fucking door because the day is fucking coming now. We'll see what they can do when I'm fucking gone. I'm so fucking pissed off."
History would prove him right.
Yeah, history would prove him right. Shortly after the tape was released, Pellini apologized. "I take full responsibility for these comments, blah, blah, blah. They were spoken in a private room following the Ohio State game. Somebody secretly recorded that in a media room." I don't know why he was saying it in front of any kind of media, but he basically says, "I again apologize to anyone who I have offended." When you criticize the Nebraska faithful, they're not going to look kindly to that.
It is funny though, yeah, like how right he's proven, like Xavier points out. Like the visualization I have in my head is like the meme where the heretics are telling Jesus to shut up and they hated him because he told the truth.
Yes.
So Pellini, with a few profanities, he did speak some truths there, it turns out.
It's the Eric Andre meme of like, "You hate me because I'm right."
Yeah.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. Does Eric Andre shoot Hannibal Buress? Nebraska fans shoot Bo Pellini and ask why they suddenly no longer have any wins.
Yeah, why have you done this to us? All right. So that was, the whole tumult of his career all happened in a short 2.5 years while I was there. In this time, so if this was on-field conduct, I don't even remember this being as big of a deal as it was. I remember thinking, kind of downplaying it in my head. The second controversy before which, or after which, I will tell a couple of my own personal stories from my time there. On-field conduct, Pellini's behavior was again called into question during Nebraska's nationally televised loss to the Iowa Hawkeyes at the end of the 2013 regular season. Again, just at the end of my freshman year. At halftime, the coach snapped at ESPN on ABC reporter Quint Kesenich when asked about a pair of Cornhusker turnovers, responding with, "What kind of question is that?" Later, in disagreement with a call made on the field, Pellini swung his hat within inches of an official's face, drawing a 15-yard penalty for unsportsmanlike conduct. Pellini remained defiant in the post-game press conference, referring to his personal foul call as chicken shit and declaring, "If they want to fire me, go ahead. I don't apologize for anything I've done." Pellini subsequently apologized for his behavior after the Iowa game.
Love a good Wikipedia article.
Yeah, it's really good.
I love when an editor clearly had a tiny bit of fun.
Yes. This was at his time in Youngstown, which I was not obviously there for. During the 2015 November 14th game against North Dakota State Bison, in the fourth quarter, Pellini engaged in the referees in several heated arguments for penalties they called during two unsportsmanlike conduct penalties on Pellini. He was reprimanded by the Missouri Valley Football Conference for his on-field conduct. You could say he gets into heated arguments. He is very, very passionate and knows that he deserves a modicum more respect than he is given, to say the least. So in my time at Nebraska, Bo was probably, and this was even before the word meme was like super popular, but he was the most meme worthy head coach in college football. I hadn't thought about bringing this up. There was a Twitter account that to this day seems to be still active. Yeah, still active. Has 609,000 followers on Twitter called Faux Pellini. The Twitter header and profile picture are of a photoshopped image of I will say this. Bo Pellini does not smile for camera. And the picture of him on the Faux Pellini site is a picture of him. It is a blank stare with mouth slightly open, looking straight down the barrel of the camera. It has been photoshopped onto a man who did a Christmas photo shoot headshot with a cat. It's very funny. Like if anybody's seen this, it's hilarious. Faux Pellini was pretty legendary in my time in Nebraska. Every Friday before the game, he would come out with some sort of like meme images that he would put together between players and coaches. And all of it was like parody. And by the time you read 10 of them, you realize that every one of these people like have their own characters. My offensive coordinator at UNLV was the offensive line coach in Nebraska, Barney Cotton. And he would be a character within this cartoon, this like little cartoon spread that he had. And it became a very funny just among the fans and the players. I mean, like we would talk about the different stuff that Faux Pellini is talking. It's just, it paints Bo as kind of belligerent and not as smart as he is, which it's parody, obviously. And he does have a sense of humor about it. He would never complain about it openly to us. I'm sure it got on his nerves a little bit, but I think he did have a sense of humor about it. Well, I know he had a sense of humor about it because in the 2014 spring game, my first spring game at Nebraska, because I joined 2013 summer, and I don't know how much you guys know about the college football season, but you have your season, and then during the winter and early spring, you give the guys some time off. Mostly you're lifting, you're doing some on-field speed work, but then you get some time in the spring to be able to practice again and get your offense installed. And it all culminates with a spring game for the fans. And most college football programs don't have the same kind of show. Like Nebraska fans show out for the spring game and nearly sell out the stadium. Nebraska has a legendary locker room underneath the stadium, partially to come out of the tunnel. They call it the tunnel walk. It's to the 1990s Chicago Bulls intro music. And, you know, you walk out, you're high-fiving fans and stuff.
I was just going to say, they repeated the same intro for the volleyball team, did they not recently?
I'm sure they did. Yeah, I'm sure they did.
They did.
I believe they got the Chicago Bulls music treatment as well. I know they got the full walkout. I think they got the exact same music.
As they should. I mean, the volleyball team is dominant. So in the 2014 spring game, the tunnel walk happens. And the whole time there is a camera person walking backwards to be able to, you know, get the front. Usually the captains are up front out there. And Bo walks out carrying a cat in his arms as a homage to Faux Pellini. And when he gets to the entrance of the field, he holds it up Simba style for the whole fans. The crowd is going nuts. That's how big Faux Pellini was at that time. He's obviously huge still, but there's just a legendary picture. Look it up. Bo Pellini holding up a cat on a football field. It's so funny. And I got to be part of that moment. I'm just so proud of that. Like, it shows, like, he has a great sense of humor. And I'll tell the only other story that I have that's like, just not like a, didn't come public or anything like that. This was just something that happened in the locker room. So this is 2013 season, I believe. So before my freshman year, guys were getting caught with their cell phones in meetings, and you can have your cell phone on you. You're not encouraged to have your cell phone on you, but just don't, you know, have it on silent. Don't be looking at it. You know, it's the same rules for meetings today and stuff. You're not supposed to have your phone in football meetings. And when your phone goes off in a team meeting and as like a text chime or a phone call, obviously people are it's going to be embarrassing. Coaches are going to get on you. So I think there were a couple moments where guys got caught. Coach Bo says, guys, don't have your phones. Keep them in your locker. You don't need them. You have your iPads. You can write notes. Just like look at your phone later. So this is coming up to the later part of training camp. I wish I could remember his name, but I can't right now. I think he was a senior with the team. All the seniors sit front row. It's always it's an honor to be able to in the team room, which was beautiful, wood walls, and all the chairs are great. All the seniors in the front row, and Bo starts talking about today's second practice. You know, this is still during the days of two-a-days. and he's talking about second practice and what we're trying to get done. Everybody's kind of in their gear to get lined up for practice. And very shortly into that meeting, I want to say his name's Kevin. You hear a phone go off in the front row, and everybody's like, oh, like everybody knows what's coming. He's going to blow up. Shit rolls downhill. He's going to get pissed. He's going to get pissed off at us at practice. It's just going to be a crappy practice. And Poe like kind of puts his hands on his hips for a moment, looks down, says, give me your phone. Like, what? No, he's senior. He's like kind of being rebellious. Like, I'm not giving you my phone. It's like, give me your phone. It's like, no, give me the phone. He holds it up, takes it out of his hand, goes to the podium, takes out a hammer. And everyone was like, what's going on? He takes out a full on hammer, places the phone on the ground, and smashes it 3 times with the head of the hammer. And everybody's like, holy shit. He lost his damn mind. Like, I'm thinking, like, who's going to pay for this phone? He's like, this isn't just like going to be okay. Like, what's going on? And Kevin is like, screw this. I am out. Like, this is absolute bullshit. Walks out of the team room. And Bo is kind of like gawking there too. It's like, you did not just walk out on me. He says, I'll be right back to the team. He says, I'll be right back. And storms out of the room following his, hey, Kevin. Slams the door behind him. And then all you hear is you hear the door like slamming in on itself and like somebody bumping into it. And everyone's like, oh my God, they're fighting. They're like in a full on like punching match or like they're wrestling or something right now. And the coaches are like, stay seated. Everybody's standing up. Like, what do we do? Do we go stop?
Everyone wants to go watch.
Yes. Everyone wants to watch or stop them or something. All the coaches are like, stay seated. We'll get this figured out. And suddenly, while everybody's at their heightened moment, the overhead screen turns on and says, gotcha, let's go to the movies. And it was somebody's like old phone that they had called to be able to start this whole thing. And instead of having our second practice, we went to the movie theater that night as a team to get a break from fall camp. And I just remember, this dude is crazy. Like, the amount of stuff that he will do just to pull a fast one on us is wild. Like, I don't know whose idea that was, but it was so perfectly executed. So that's my favorite story coming out of Nebraska. I don't know if it's one that many people know. Oh man, we saw so many movies because we would just, whenever we have a game every Saturday before we go to the hotel, we end up having like a movie night. We go to the local movie theater. We saw a ton of good ones. We saw Prisoners with Hugh Jackman one time.
Yeah, Denis Villeneuve.
Yeah. We saw The Equalizer one time. I can't remember a lot of them, but they're all pretty good. I remember them being a pretty high hit rate. I don't remember what movie that one was, but yeah, that was a great moment. And we didn't end up having a moment like that before the 2014 season. I was always waiting, like, when are we going to have that practice canceled so we can go to the movies? And it didn't come. It was like the worst feeling.
What I appreciate about that is the self-awareness that he needs to be able to pull off that joke. Because he needs to know, like, oh, they think I would do this. They think I would smash the shit out of this phone.
I mean, the crazy part for me is, like, why does he even have a hammer at his podium? Like, why does he, like, of course he's just been waiting for this moment.
When you said he lost his mind, I'm like, this is clearly premeditated. He clearly came ready to smash someone's phone.
Oh, in the lore that was created in that minute-long, like, storyline, it was very clear that that was going to happen to the next person whose phone went off in a team meeting. And he could not wait to bring out the hammer. It was so perfectly executed that I'm just happy to have been there for that moment. To bring down the mood just a little bit, I will talk about the second audio tape leak. And that's the last thing I will talk about for Bo. Again, he's a hothead, as you know, and he's self-aware as a hothead. This was a very interesting time at Nebraska. Obviously, we could kind of feel the fact that he was going to get fired soon. We had a new AD. He did not like him. And he had a team meeting I think this was right after he got fired, brings us into the team room and talks to us and basically says, hey, I love you guys. You know, whatever they got going on here, like, don't listen to what they have to say. Like, you guys know me. Basically just trying to defend himself amongst the players, because obviously it was very obvious to us that, like, the player's idea of him and the reputation that he has solely among the players was what was important to him. He didn't care about what anybody else thought except for his players and coaching staff. So he talked to us, and, you know, just the way that Bo is, he was going to get a little bit fiery towards other people outside of the room. So there was somebody, to this day, I don't think anybody knows who it was. I've heard so many allegations, but I don't think necessarily any of them were true. Somebody recorded it, similar to post Ohio State game with the comeback. Somebody recorded it on their cell phone and released it to somebody. And that went public. However, that was not the second audio tape leak. That was not the second audio tape leak. That was technically the second one. There was a third one. That's the third one's the one that got put on Wikipedia. After that all went public, and, like, they were like, Bo, you cannot be on school premises anymore talking to the team. They're not your players. So the chief of staff for his coaching staff, I think like a week or two later, before we had a new head coach, like, nothing was really going on in the program. This is right after the season. He gives everybody a text, or at least has the players kind of gather everybody together through text threads saying, hey, Bo is going to talk to us, but we have to go to an off-site high school campus. I don't know how he got this location, but we went to a auditorium for a high school that was, like, on the east side of Lincoln. And I remember thinking it was so weird. I got a ride there with one of my teammates. And when I get there, everybody else is already in the auditorium. They're kind of just waiting for us. You see there's chief of staff and Bo is up on, like, the stage for this auditorium. And we all just find our seat, and it was just his opportunity to vent more to us, you know, with the guys that he knows and loves in the locker room and spent so much time with. And what was so disappointing for him was the fact that he, and I apologize to anybody who knows the story better than I do, who remembers more clearly than I do, because I'm pretty sure this was in response to an audio leak. But he took the opportunity basically to just rag badly on everybody who was, again, outside of the room. And that's what the second audio tape leak is. Following his firing on November 30th of 2014, Pellini met with his former team at a local high school in December 2nd. I don't know why local high school has a hyperlink. It's Lincoln North Star High School. That's why. there's a Wikipedia page there. On December 2nd, leaked audio of the meeting revealed that the coach verbally attacked the University of Nebraska administration. At one point, Pellini said, again, it's not my words, it was a surprise to me. No, it wasn't a surprise to me. It really wasn't. I didn't have any relationship with the AD. The guy, you guys saw him. He's a total pussy. I mean, he is. He's a total, and I won't say this one, C word. After the leak, Nebraska administration released a statement saying, if these comments were indeed spoken by Mr. Pellini, we are extremely disappointed, blah, blah, blah. Youngstown State, who had already hired Pellini, said, Coach Pellini's remarks are reported as inappropriate and unfortunate. We have discussed the report with Coach. We are confident that Coach will conduct himself accordingly moving forward. All that stuff. So somebody had, for a second time, not even a second time, a third time, but a second time for one of the players, recorded one of his private talks to us and released it. And that was just, like, the least of what was said, to be honest. Like, he took it out on everybody. In retrospect, possibly rightfully so. I don't know. I'm not going to judge that. But that was an explosive end to Coach Bo Pellini's time at Nebraska. Here's his record. In his time as the Nebraska head coach, yeah, he didn't have a season under 9 wins during his time in Nebraska. He went 9-4, 10-4, 10-4, 9-4, 10-4, 9-4, 9-3. Obviously, the extra game being a bowl game. Finished his time in Nebraska 67-27. His in-conference schedule, he was 39-17. And that's what got him fired.
That's the
legacy of Bo Pellini.
It's especially a thing that I think is unique to this generation. Where, because I feel like in the 60s and 70s, if you're cranking out 9-win seasons and you're graduating all your kids,
In the 60s and 70s, you didn't have tape recorders to follow along also, with your head coach. Also.
Well, only specifically tape recorders, and they're a little too chunky, I feel like, to hide in the locker room.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you didn't have it on everybody's device that they kept on them at all times. So since then, he, you know, coached Youngstown State for a couple years. He moved on to defensive coordinator at LSU for a couple years, 2020, a tough season following Joe Burrow's leaving, and it was Coach O's last season there. But yeah, he is not a coach right now. During that interview that I just listened to, he thinks that, you know, maybe his next stop would be in the NFL, which he has the, you know, the credibility to do so. But he is a absolute, like, legendary character of college football. A great coach, but the stories around him are unmatched.
Well, I think all of that was a great story, and much like USA, characters are welcome here. I the thing that jumps out to me immediately is, like, a 9-win coach, that feels like a guy. Someone that consistently can give you 9 wins. You're starting at a very good point there without any intangibles, because nowadays you probably don't make the college football playoff with that. You are still probably going to consistently make a bowl.
It's, but he was consistently, like, those games where they played 14 games was because they were in a conference championship game.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, conference championship and bowl game. So then the 13th and 14th game.
Just the right mixture of success and failure to be a notable guy. You can't be hitting all the high notes.
Right. To appear in the conference championship 4 times, but not quite conquer that last hill to win the Big Ten championship. We always love those, like, close but just not quite there. Because if they got they'd have elevated that guy.
Exactly. I feel like I understood the premise of a guy isn't top of the pyramid, top of the mountain. It's the guy who barely didn't make it. And he's a guy.
Yeah. It is a nebulous term. There is a certain je ne sais guy, but if it's a champion, Gadget Jones is the one that's down the bench with the Bulls.
Right. Yeah. So we had one guy. He was Hakeem Olajuwon's backup that was signed 3 days before the playoffs started. So he won a championship, but because of the fact that he's just the backup to Hakeem, everybody kind of forgot about him, still can retain that guy status. So it is different levels of ability as they correlate with different levels of team success. It's kind of like that. It's a moving scale.
Yeah. So I bring Bo Pelini to the guy Punel.
I mean, just what Johnny said, you know, when he was starting, is someone who people thought about a lot, and then no one has thought about in 5 years. I was like, yeah, we did, especially on, like, the kind of heyday of Twitter, the 2013 to 2017 range. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, there was a lot of talk about Bo Pelini all the time. He was always something else coming up, and then just, like, have not thought of him in, like, 5 years. And
yeah, and he got to LSU at, like, video the perfectly the wrong cat. Time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he got, just because it was right after they won the national championship, takes over the DC job, and then they just take a big downward spiral that next season. And since then, he hasn't had a job. And probably through his own, like, decision. I think that he is absolutely worthy of being, at the very least, a head coach in D1.
Well, sure. The first time he was at... Was he at LSU? Yeah, he is there for the championship the first time. He does win the 2007 one. That was what I wanted to check.
Oh, yes.
I'm shocked by how young he is, because...
I know. I forget that he was 55.
Because Frank Solich, it was still coaching until, like, 2 years ago, and he's 79. So I think Frank Solich's head coaching career ended after Bo Pelini's head coaching career did, despite being 25 years older than him. I just assumed that Bo Pelini was in his mid to late 60s at this point.
Mm-hmm.
He could still come back. He could still come back.
Absolutely. We haven't heard the last of Bo Pelini.
Right. Like, he's at the point where he can be discerning in where he wants to land next. Like, you don't just jump at the first offer just because it's there. You wait for the right one.
Right.
Someone's going to look to him the way that baseball teams look to Buck Showalter. Like, he can fix us. He's been waiting in the rafters for a while. He can come over here and fix us. But speaking of timing, Johnny and Xavier now have both said things that I think really kind of sum up something I like about Bo Pelini. Everything that's happening is happening very much at the right moment. Like, he is coming of a time when a Twitter parody account of a coach like can exist in the first place, because Twitter has any of that cultural cachet and is not like slowly dying at that point. At the same time, like, he is existing in a time when phone recordings can be made of meetings, and that's not possible prior to then. And as you said, maybe without that, he's got a much longer time in Nebraska if people just can't hear what is said to you all. It's
And I think it's what's so interesting is I don't know how many characters there have been around college football. There's always like one or two people surrounding college football that kind of take up all the space in the room. I haven't followed college football like really closely in a long time. I feel like the last time we really had one of those was Joe Burrow at LSU, and just like the amount of presence that he had along with Coach Orgeron. And I think I put Bo in that same category of just like, you are always going to be talking about him when he's at his like high point. Like, there was a long period there that there was just something was always going on. And there, I don't know how many, like how often we've had somebody like that in college football.
Deion, what, now. Bo Pelini walks, Deion so Deion Sanders that. Can run.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
I was going to say, Bo Pelini to me feels like the defensive coordinator's answer to Mike Leach. Like, they're two sides of kind of the same coin.
Ooh. I would, man, rest in peace, Coach Leach. I've had a bunch of buddies who played for him, and the stories that they have, I was honestly considering coming with Mike Leach, but I felt like his story wasn't mine to tell because I know so many people who could tell incredible stories of him.
And for the record, he's not that one covered. He is actually a guy emeritus.
Oh, perfect. Perfect. I'm glad that I didn't come to the guy bunal with somebody who was already taken. But yeah, I would have paid a lot of money for a Hard Knocks type show where Bo Pelini is the defensive coordinator, Mike Leach is the head coach or offensive coordinator.
If those two are running each unit, the team's either going 12-0 or 0-12. Like, there's no middle ground with that team. Either it's a perfect synergy or it's just
big
too
personalities.
Much right.
Very different people from what I understand.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. It's the defensive coordinator's response to the hard nosed versus the eccentric creativity.
Yes. Eccentric is a word for it.
And Diaz, something that I just realized, if you haven't already been put over the edge, I think I am in agreement, but if you're not, going for Bo Pelini because of his multiple stints at LSU would also continue your Tiger streak from last week.
That's very true. It's very true.
You could stay
Tigers,
now on brand with the Tigers.
Tigres from the Mexican
Tigres
Soccer League. Yes, Tigres del Lice. Yeah, I mean, I think Xavier, if I don't speak too hastily, I do think this guy Bunal is in agreement. College football is the sport that it is, the institution that it is, because of the pageantry and the personalities that surround it. And what's really important is to have a leader in a locker room that is not just going to drill home fundamentals, but he's also going to be self-aware enough to smash a phone as a prank and realize that that's going to go over pretty well, to lean into his Twitter personality, to create some controversies, but at the same time, ultimately say some truths. I think these are all qualities befitting of a guy, and it is our duty to acknowledge that and to welcome our first defensive coordinator, not our first defensive coordinator, but I think the defensive coordinator that we're most proud to welcome, certainly at this time, into our Hall of Guy, Bo Pelini. Welcome to the Hall of Guy.
Willkommen, bienvenue.
Round of applause for Bo.
But we do have one more honorific that we have to give out now. Johnny, as we said, you are by far the most reputable athlete to ever join us and humor us with some stories.
He is more reputable athletes than me.
It is not for lack of trying.
hopefully it's the watershed moment. And
low,
you know,
bar.
One thing that we say about a lot of guys is they open doors for other guys. We hope that you're going to open the door for more athletes to join us. But we do know that you're going to be the first athlete to join us to be inducted into our hall, because if there's anything that screams football guy, it's a quarterback that reinvents himself as a fullback and then manages to score a touchdown on that pass from Case Keenum in the NFL.
Thank you. We didn't get into that. So people are probably confused why that got brought up. But yeah, I used to play quarterback. But thank you.
Right. And I get before I do the official induction, I did want to ask you about that earlier. It just didn't quite fit in. When you make that transition to becoming sort of the Swiss Army knife, how does that conversation go? Is that something that it was your idea originally? Did a coach come to you and say, this is how you can get on the field? How did that go?
Bold of you to think that there was a conversation. I knew that quarterback wasn't going to be my future in the NFL, considering my college career was nothing to write home about. But I knew that I could hopefully razzle dazzle some people with my athleticism. So at Pro Day 2018, after my redshirt senior season, which I only played a couple games in, only three of them a quarterback, two of them a linebacker, two of them a special teams, I'm like, okay, why don't I just kind of dive into that adaptability and take reps at quarterback, tight end, linebacker, and long snapper. So on a hot late spring day in Las Vegas, that was pretty tiring. And I got an opportunity to try out for the Vikings because they liked enough of what they saw, but it was at tight end. So they're hoping that I could learn enough about tight end within like a couple weeks or a couple days, really, within rookie minicamp, which I'd never played before. So I do well enough to the point where obviously they end up taking me on. Over the course of that next day, they're like, hey, we're going to get you doctor's appointments. Okay, you made the team. Amazing. We're going to ship you back home. I need to graduate still from UNLV, so they need to send me back to Las Vegas. And I'm at the airport with one of the other guys who made the team. There were four of us who made the team out by tryout, which meant four guys had to get cut. So they're making that announcement on their Twitter account, and I'm getting a whole bunch of responses, and I hadn't told really anybody besides my family. And I was looking forward to seeing that Twitter post, and then finally it comes and it says all the guys, their number, the position they're playing, and then it gets to Johnny Stanton, number 48, fullback. I'm like, that's a surprise. Did not hear about that before. So I guess I need to learn how to play in another position. Obviously that's the one that stuck, but yeah, no, since then I've head first into it, absolutely taking on the mantle of fullback, and make fullbacks great again. I don't know if you guys follow the Twitter account, but you got to lead the charge to get fullbacks in the world of the NFL again.
Pat Ricard is excellent. I'm.
Oh yeah,
I love Kyle Juszczyk. So
yeah, dude, we've had Ricard, Juszczyk, and Leach. I think in an unbroken chain Leach, at this point for like a decade.
Nice. Oh yeah.
There is exactly one city that deeply, deeply, deeply appreciates fullbacks.
That's true. Yeah, who knows what if there's any future for me in the NFL? I hope that there is. Hope it's at fullback. I'm doing a lot of work at long snapping. Hopefully there's something for me at long snapper. But even if my football career is done, I'm really happy with what I've done. And you won't hear the last of me, hopefully.
Well, of course, because as you could, do you want to plug it one more time coming out?
Yeah,
it came out Friday.
Yeah, I've got the Path of the Gridiron Barbarian subclass. If you're a D&D fan, even if you're not, go check out D&D Backstory's recent video, or most recent video. Halloween Heartbreaker Holthrop is the character that I voiced. And alongside it, we are re-releasing my Path of the Gridiron Barbarian t-shirt in a different colorway. So go check out unitetherealm.com or .co.uk to check out that shirt. And then, check out my website if you want to play the subclass, and follow me on social media to be able to check in with Athletics Check, where if you're a nerd, you get to learn about sports. If you're a jock, you get to learn about nerdy shit. So,
and while we don't necessarily have the hugest audience, we do have one that largely fits the Venn diagram of that.
I love that. Love it. There are dozens of us.
Dozens!
And I don't think I officially said it, so just to punctuate it. The Please, fourth yeah. of his name, but the first into our hall. Welcome to the Hall of Guy.
Thank you. I really appreciate that.
No, thank you so much, dude. We really we appreciate you coming on. We do also have some others to thank, of course. We've got producer Craig and all the coders behind it. Our musical director, Don Hamm, for our lovely theme music, and you, D dear listener. Much like Johnny has all of his stuff collected at those various sites, we too have all of our stuff collected in one place, which is bit.ly/rememberthatguy, all one word, all lowercase. We got the guys of the day. We got the Discord. We're on Blue Sky now because Twitter is slowly failing its death throes. But so yeah, feel free to check all that out, share it around. Anything else from the three of you on our way out?
No, thank you for having me, guys.
The pleasure is ours. Absolutely.
The pleasure has indeed ours, and during this time, I have been James.
I've been the very special guest, Xavier.
I am the paragon of truth, Johnny Stanton IV.
I've been Diaz, and as Coach Taylor says in Friday Night Lights, clear guys, full backs, can't lose.